in his grace and allow the word of God to grow abundantly in us. We have also been made new wineskins, capable of being filled with the Holy Spirit, who turns us into his temple. So it is possible for us to walk in such power. Jesus apparently thought so, and he said as much in John 14:12. Truly, truly, I say to you, he who believes in me and the works that I do, he will do also, and greater works than these he will do, because I go to my Father, in Luke 22:29. And just as my Father has granted me a kingdom, guess what? I grant you. That's pretty important. Now look at Luke 24:49. And behold, I am sending forth the promise of the Holy Spirit of my Father upon you. But you are to stay in the city until you are clothed with power from on high. Nothing is holding us back. Guess what? Nothing is holding us back but we ourselves. We have the same arsenal from which Jesus had to draw, just in lesser measure. But that measure is more than sufficient. We are Christ here on this earth. Man has power to become God, has sanctioned him to have power. Man has power because God has sanctioned him to have power. We were created in his image. We have the word of God's authority. We have the Holy Spirit and power. We need nothing else. Let us walk boldly under this sanction, doing the works of God. Romans 13:1, let every soul be subject unto the higher powers, for there is no power but God. The powers that be are ordained of God. We need to understand that Romans chapter 13 teaches Christians to be subject to governing authorities. For there is no authority except from God, and the authorities that exist are appointed by God. Now whether this passage speaks of church leadership, civil servants, or higher levels of government doesn't matter. What's important to know is that God is the supreme dispenser of all authority. Corinthians teaches that the head of every man is Christ, the head of every woman is man, and the head of Christ is God. This is a divine arrangement for protection, stability, harmony, and tranquility. When people work within God's perfect arrangement, they have his covering, protection, and blessing. In Luke 10:19, Jesus gave authority to his disciples, giving them power to tread on serpents and scorpions and power the enemy. Believe me, living in Arizona, that's an important verse. Now, from Pentecost on, all Christians have God-given authority to do the same. Ephesians teaches that Christians are members of the body of Christ, that Jesus Christ is the head of his body, and all things are under his feet. Therefore, all things are subject to his church. The prophet Hosea wrote that God's people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. Many Christians are defeated because they lack understanding of God's arrangement and delegation of authority. However, God has abundantly equipped Christians to live victoriously, exercising God-given spiritual authority and power. That is what this e-crusade is all about, finding out who you are in Christ, how he has transferred his power to the Christian, and how the Christian can and you and should use that power that is within you. In closing again, look at the Christian's power. We find that there are three main components of that power. As I pointed out, God placed man on this earth as his representatives and partners. God was the owner, the man was his manager in his image. Man answered to no one but God, to God himself. With this responsibility came the necessary authority and dominion. Man was God's underlord, God's face and voice to the world. As long as man carried this mantle, man's word would be in all respects the very word of God. The Bible is as much the true living word of God in it as it still is, because his word actually walked this earth and spoke it to us directly. And because of this, it still is the word of God, even when we repeat it out of our mouths. The more we take in the word, the more we become like Jesus, the word. The more we become like him, the more we are able to walk like him. We walk in authority when we walk under the authority of the word of God. And the Holy Spirit resides within the born-again child of God. The Old Testament believers couldn't experience the Holy Spirit in this fashion, and only those in three offices could experience the Holy Spirit coming upon them. The offices of prophet, priest, and king. As I previously told you, that when Jesus came, he referred to himself over 80 times as the Son of Man, rarely as the Son of God. When he did it, it was usually in the third person. He definitely is, was, and always has been the Son of God. But he walked on this earth as the Son of Man. He became the Son of Man in the incarnation, God becoming flesh and walking as the Son of Man like us. But with one big difference, the Son of Man, Jesus, was, is, and always will be sinless, a Son of Mankind's form. Jesus walked as we walk so that we can walk as he walked. This is the mystery of the gospel miracles. God's power in this world comes through faith in God, made possible through the work of Jesus Christ. Mark 11:22-23, Jesus said to them, "Have faith in God. I can guarantee this truth. This is what will be done for someone who doesn't doubt but believes what he says will happen. He can say to this mountain, 'Be uprooted and thrown into the sea,' and it will be done for him. That's why I tell you to have faith that you have already received whatever you pray for, and it will be yours." Yes, Jesus is the link between God and man, 100% God and 100% man. This is referred to again as the hypostatic union. Jesus operated in the power and authority of a spirit-filled man while he was in the flesh. This is why he told us that what he did, we could do greater, because the same Holy Spirit would reside in all of God's children. Yes, we have access to the same authority only within the confines of the Word of God and only through the use of his name. When we are born from above and his Spirit is placed within us, we are again able to walk as the Son of Man in this realm and do his works. We do not become the Son of Man, but rather we are given the privileged ability and power to walk in his complete authority as long as we do his works. We become the children of God. Matthew 28:18. And Jesus came up and spoke to them, saying, "All authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth." John 14:13-14. "Whatever you ask in my name, I will do, so that the..." "So that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If you ask me anything in my name, I will do it." John 15:7-8. "If you abide in me and my words abide in you, ask whatever you wish. It will be done for you. My Father is glorified by this, that you bear much fruit and so prove to be my disciples." Yes, yes, yes. If you work the word works. In this, the sacrificial work of the second Adam, Jesus, has regained for mankind the position lost by the sin of the first Adam. We can now walk as God's stewards in this world, having been recreated back into his image. The Son of God can now legally empower a Son of Man to act in his stead and do the will of God the Father. In this, God is glorified in this world. The Holy God is a loving God, a just God, and our Father. Before this, if you could have asked Moses, who was responsible for the miracle parting of the Red Sea, he would have said God. If you could ask God, who was responsible for the miracle parting of the Red Sea, he might say Moses. There is no difference in the final result between God parting the Red Sea 100% on his own and God choosing to part the Red Sea through a 100% yielded vessel like Moses. The water still divides, and the poor Egyptians still get drowned. Remember, God appears to prefer working his glory through obedient, trusting individuals. The Bible says that he searches the world over for individuals in whom he can show himself strong. This doesn't make God any less of God, nor does it make the individual any more of God. It is simply God choosing to work his will as he sees fit. Also remember that Jesus was 100% God, but he took on the form of a servant in the incarnation and walked as a man, yielded to God, 100% yielded to God. It was God the Father working through God the Holy Spirit who was residing within Jesus, the incarnate Son of God, which worked the miracles. There is no end result difference between God directly working a miracle and God working a miracle through a yielded vessel. God's power in this world comes through a faith in God, made possible through the work of Jesus Christ. God chooses to stay behind the scenes and work through others to bring about his will. Of the 214 instances in the New Testament where the Holy Spirit is mentioned, 51 of those, almost 25%, are in the book of Acts. So it's no coincidence that the book that chronicles the first Acts of the Apostles is filled with mention of the Holy Spirit, the source of all miracles. The book of Acts is sometimes called the Acts of the Holy Spirit. The more you are yielded to Him, the more you are Him. Paul said it as well when he wrote, "I can do all things through Him who strengthens me." And Jesus Himself said, "All things are possible to him who believes." The more we seek God and seek His will, the more He and His will are revealed in us and through us. Dr. Steph.
Thank you. That was wonderful. Oops,
bring
wait
a
minute.
On.
I've got. Thanks. That was wonderful. Thank you very much. That was great. And I don't know if we'll see you back this afternoon, right? We're not sure, or we are sure.
Well, as much as she's trying to reach me, I kind of doubt it.
Okay. All right. Well, we'll see you tomorrow then.
Absolutely.
For sure. All right. God bless you. Thanks so much. It was wonderful. Old messages
thank
were
you.
Just really loaded with dynamite. I loved them. Okay.
God bless you. Go forward today.
All right. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye.
All right, my friends. I'm going to talk to you right now after a brief interlude for a potty break. I'm going to talk to you about our position of authority as believers, okay? But let me get you some music, because I think you deserve it, and you're nice peoples, and I'm going to play you this lovely song. Where is it now? It is right there. This is a beautiful song by Lauren Talley.
Behold the Lamb, I will worship, seated high upon the throne. Behold the Lamb, I will honor, magnify the Holy One, my joy and laughter, the love that I'm after, the only thing that matters to me. High upon the throne.
I love it. Our position of authority as believers. When you made Jesus Christ the Lord of your life, Colossians 1:13 says that you were delivered from the power of darkness. I know this sounds redundant. It doesn't matter. It's getting in your heart. This is an immersion that we're doing. The word power is literally translated as authority, and you have been delivered from the power or authority of darkness and placed into God's kingdom. Now Jesus said, "All power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. Go ye therefore." Matthew 28, verses 18 and 19. You know, my friends, that power was given to you as part of your inheritance in Christ Jesus. You have entered into this position of authority because you are in Him, in Christ. Now, the Word says that righteousness has come upon all men, Romans 5:18. So you may ask, then, why don't all men become righteous? Well, here's why. Because in order to receive it, you have to act on righteousness from the point of authority. November 2nd, 1973, I used my authority as a human being and made a choice. I made the decision to receive Jesus as Lord of my life. At that moment, the righteousness that had been upon me came inside of me. It didn't just become inside me, it came inside me. I was made the righteousness of God in Christ in the twinkling of an eye. 2 Corinthians 5:21 says, "He hath made him to be sin for us who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him." We gave up our self-righteousness, which was really filthy rags, okay, and took Jesus' righteousness. And now we have died to self. We are no longer living beings like in the natural sense of the word. We are spiritually alive, and we have an earth suit. You know, I'm just like normal. I'm not saying we're, you know, zombies. That's not what I'm saying. What I am saying is we cognizantly made a decision to die to self so that we could take on the character, the attributes, and activate them of Christ and God in our lives. So Jesus secured our power and authority. Jesus actually succeeded in securing all power. How? By going to the cross, dying a horrible death, suffering the penalty for sin, and defeating Satan in the pit of hell. All right? He came to earth as a man for two reasons: to recapture the authority Satan had stolen through Adam's disobedience in the garden, and to show us our God, our Father. Jesus was called the last Adam. 1 Corinthians 15:45. After securing that power, the authority, he freely gave it over to the hands of those who would believe on him, you and me. Okay? And it's not just you and me, it's all believers. It's not enough for us just to simply accept Jesus' work on the cross at Calvary. I want you to understand this. We are held responsible for much more. Jesus' words in Mark 16 were not intended for the early church alone. Oh no. His words are just as vital and real today as when they were first spoken. You see, now when the Sabbath was passed, Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James, and Salome brought spices that they might come and anoint him. Very early in the morning, on the first day of the week, they came to the tomb when the sun had risen, and they said among themselves, "Who will roll away the stone from the door of the tomb for us?" But when they looked up, they saw that the stone had been rolled away, for it was very large, and entering the tomb, they saw a young man clothed in a long white robe sitting on the right side, and they were alarmed. But he said to them, "Do not be alarmed. You seek Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He is risen. He's not here. See the place where they laid him? But go, tell his disciples and Peter that he is going before you into Galilee. There you will see him, as he said to you." So they went out. Quickly they fled from the tomb, for they trembled and were amazed, and they said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid. Now when he rose early on the first day of the week, he appeared first to Mary Magdalene, out of whom he had cast seven demons. She went and told those who had been with him, as they mourned and wept. And when they heard that he was alive and had been seen by her, they didn't believe it. After that, he appeared in another form to two of them as they walked and went into the country. And they went and told it to the rest of them, but they did not believe them either. Later, he appeared to the 11 as they sat at the table, and he rebuked their unbelief and hardness of heart because they didn't believe those who had seen him after he had risen. And he said to them, "Go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. He who believes and is baptized will be saved, but he who does not believe will be condemned. And these signs will follow those who believe. In my name they will cast out demons. They will speak with new tongues. They will take up serpents, and if they drink anything deadly, it will by no means hurt them. They will lay hands on the sick, and they will recover." So then, after the Lord had spoken to them, he was received up into heaven and sat down at the right hand of God. And they went out and preached everywhere the Lord was working with them and confirming the word through the accompanying signs. Amen. All right, so Jesus appeared to his disciples after his resurrection from the dead, and his words to them form the basic foundation for the work of the New Covenant and the New Testament church. It was at that time he delegated the authority to carry out that work. Beginning in verse 15, Jesus said, "Go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved, but he that believeth not shall be damned. And these signs shall follow them that believe. In my name they shall cast out devils, they shall speak with new tongues, they shall take up serpents, and if they drink any deadly thing, it shall not hurt them. They shall lay hands on the sick, and they shall recover." Mark 16, 15 through 18. Okay, you see, we have been given authority to preach the gospel. That's plain. He said, "Go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature." Okay, every born-again believer has the authority and responsibility to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ in this earth. If you can't go, you can send someone in your place. "And these signs shall follow them that believe." All right, notice who's supposed to do all these things. Them that believe. The signs will follow the believers who act in faith and boldly speak in Jesus' name. They shall cast out devils. They shall speak with new tongues. They shall lay hands on the sick. You see, believers are the ones with the power and the authority to do these things. Verse 20 says, "They went forth and preached everywhere, the Lord working with them and confirming the word with signs following." God will confirm his word, but first it has to be spoken forth. That's where you and I come in. God doesn't preach. He has given us the authority to do the preaching. God will not lay hands on the sick. He will bring the healing, but you and I as believers must lay hands on the sick by faith, believing God will perform his word. Now, we know that he will. All right, we know, as you're a born-again believer, you know that when you lay hands on the sick and speak the word of God over them, that they're healed, because they were healed at the cross. All right, so all it is doing is stirring up that healing power of God that's now administered into their body, renewing it, all right, reviving it, giving it a booster shot. Okay, the person that's receiving the laying on of hands may not go with you on it. They may, you know, have a wrong idea or be afraid of it or something. That then they, if they don't see the healing manifest, it's because they've thrown up a block somehow. God, not because of what you did, because we were told to do it and you're doing it, right? God has given us the authority then to stand against Satan. See, one of the most vital areas of the believer's authority is his power to successfully stand against the enemy. Ephesians 4:27 says, "Neither give place to the devil." All right. And this is really important. Don't give him any place. Don't give him credit for stuff. He doesn't deserve it. You know what the wiles of the devil are, so what do? You just rebuke it, and he'll run. All right? You stand away from it. You turn away from it. You stay away from it. You know what it is, but you don't have to stand around and say, "Well, the devil made me do it. Well, the devil is sure working on me today." Don't give him any credit. Don't give him any place. He has no place in you. You are the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. You are in Christ Jesus. He can't have any place in you. Okay, in Ephesians 6, the Apostle Paul describes the armor that we as believers are to wear in combat against Satan. And he explains each piece of that armor. It's the armor of God, but not once does he say that God will put the armor on you or that God will fight the devil for you. You is the understood subject of these verses. He said, "You be strong in the Lord. You put on the whole armor of God, and you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. You take the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, you stand." You see, God has given you the power and the authority to stand against Satan and his destructive works. Now, he has provided the armor, but it's your responsibility as a believer to put on that armor and stand against the devil. You know, James 4:7 says, "You resist the devil and he will flee from you." The armor and the weapons are at your disposal. They're there. God's there with you to back his word. But all that's worthless, all of it's worthless, unless you take your position of authority and assume the responsibility to use what he's provided. You have the power and the authority to take the word of God, the name of Jesus, and the power of the Holy Spirit and run Satan right out of your affairs. Don't pray and ask God to fight Satan for you. He did his best for you. He gave you his best. He gave you his son. He has told you where the battlefield is. He has shown you the wiles of the devil. He has armed you, given you angels at your disposal. All you have to do is call on him. You have power, unspeakable power. I mean, it's so enormous and so huge, you can't, there's nothing we could say that would, in our vocabulary, that would give it credence. It's so big, it's bigger than you. But you're the one in authority. You're the president. You take authority. Take your responsibility and speak directly to Satan yourself and stand your ground firmly. He'll flee. You can't be a namby-pamby about it. You can't Mickey Mouse around and, oh, I'm sorry, Satan, get away from me. You can't do that. Speak the word. The Lord gave me a vision showing me that when we speak the word to the enemy and his cohorts, it hits them like a searing hot cutting laser beam, and they scream in pain and terror and flee. Pretty awesome tool, wouldn't you say? So we're seated with him, Christ, in high authority. In Ephesians 1, Paul prayed a prayer for the body of believers in Ephesus. One part of that prayer was that they know the exceeding greatness of his power to those who believe. Ephesians 1:19. Okay, that exceeding great power is the same power that God used to raise Jesus from the dead and set him at his own right hand in the heavenlies. Ephesians 1:21 tells us that Jesus is seated far above all principality and power and might and dominion and every name that is named. See, the work God did, Jesus was supreme. I mean, anything that he did in Jesus was supreme. He raised Jesus from the dead and set him far above all the other authorities, all right? Not only in his this world that we're in, but also in the heavenly world. He's above everything. Then the Ephesians verses 22 and 23 say that God has put all things under his feet and made him head over the church, which is the body. It's his body. Where are the feet? They're in the body. As believers, we are part of his body. And we're seated with him in that highly exalted place of authority. Praise God. So look at Ephesians 2, verses 1 and 5 and 6. And you hath he quickened, you who were dead in trespasses and sins. Even when we were dead in sins, God has quickened us together with Christ and has raised us up together and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. We are seated together in him and with him. Where? In him. Far above all principality and power and might and dominion. As a believer, you've accepted the substitutionary sacrifice of Jesus on the cross at Calvary. Therefore, you're part of his body, and you're seated with him. You're not only seated with him, you are in him, and that heavenly place, equipped with the same power and the same authority that he has. Wow. I mean, wow. Not just, oh, wow. You don't know what kind of power you have, my friends. The great power that God worked in Christ when he raised him from the dead is the same creative power of God that worked in you to make you alive when you were dead in your trespasses and sins. The moment you made Jesus Christ the Lord of your life, that same power was exercised on your dead, unregenerate spirit, causing it to be reborn through Christ in the likeness of God himself. You were reborn through Christ. You were born again, and you came through Christ Jesus, and now you're bone of his bone and flesh of his flesh, and with Holy Communion you have his blood, so... Any man who's in Christ Jesus is a new creation. Old things have passed away. All things are new, and all things are of God. 2 Corinthians 5:17 through 18. So, my friends, we have the power of God's word to exercise our authority. Oh, we do? Yeah. That same day, when the even was come, he saith unto them, Let us pass over to the other side. And when they had sent away the multitude, they took him even as he was in the ship. And there were also with him other little ships. And there arose a great storm of wind, and the waves beat into the ship, so that it was now full. And he was in the hinder part of the ship, asleep on a pillow. And they awakened him, and said unto him, Master, carest thou not that we perish? In other words, you don't care if we perish? And he arose and rebuked the wind, and said unto the sea, Peace, be still. Now the wind ceased, and there was a great calm. And he said unto them, Why are you so fearful? How is it that you have no faith? Mark 4, 35 through 40. Jesus spoke the words. Jesus spoke the words. Are you ready? This is what happened. He said, let us pass over unto the other side. Now, I want you to understand that there was enough power and authority in those words to accomplish the job. One thing I want you to notice is that Jesus did not take command of the ship to see that his words were carried out. He walked to the back of the boat, went down to sleep, lay down on a pillow, and went to sleep. Jesus delegated the authority to his disciples, and they accepted it. But when the chips were down, when the storm came, they were filled with fear that the boat would sink. Jesus had to carry out the responsibility of that authority, which he had delegated to them, by rebuking the wind and the sea. See the parallel here? You are the captain of your own ship. You have control over your own life and your spirit. Your soul and your body all belong to you. Jesus has delegated power and authority over Satan to you. He has given that all to you. You have the power and authority over Satan as a believer, okay? You are to give him no place in your life. Don't give that devil any place in your life. You are born of the Spirit of God. You are filled with the Spirit of God. You have been given the Word of God. Those three elements are enough to carry you, carry out your spiritual authority here in the earth forever. You don't need any more power. You have all the power necessary. Jesus said to Paul, "My grace is sufficient for you, for my strength is made perfect in weakness." So you simply have to exercise your authority. Pretty simple. Jesus has already done everything necessary to secure the authority and a power over sin, sickness, demons, and fear. You have to employ the faith action to receive that authority and join forces with him in this earth. You're the one that is to be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Listen, we have authority to act as new creations. Hebrews 2:14 says, "For as much then as the children are partakers of the flesh and blood, he also himself likewise took part of the same." Jesus partook of flesh and blood so that you could partake of spirit and life. For you to partake of that spirit and life, you must take the responsibility of standing in the place of authority as the new creation in Christ Jesus that you are. You are born again, not of corruptible seed, but of incorruptible seed, by the word of God. 1 Peter 1:23. It was the word of God Almighty that was injected into your spirit man to bring about the new birth in your life. When the church was first beginning, Acts 12:24 described it as the word growing and multiplying. Now, I need to see what time it is. 12:03. Okay, I'm good. I think, yeah. I'm still good. Acts 12:24 described it as the word growing and multiplying. The word is in you, but you're the one who must be willing to allow it to work in you. All right? Ephesians 4:21 through 24 says this: "If so be that ye have heard him, if it is that you've heard him and have been taught by him, as the truth is in Jesus, that you put off concerning the former conversation the old man, which is corrupt according to the deceitful lusts, and be renewed in the spirit of your mind, and that you put on the new man, which after God is created in righteousness and true holiness." You're the one in authority. It's your responsibility to put off the old man, the unregenerate man that you were before you accepted Christ. And then the Holy Spirit does the actual work in you, but you must make the decision to allow him to do it. God has never forced his will on any person. He's not going to start now. You put off the old man. You use the word of God to renew your mind. You put on the new man, which is created in the righteousness and true holiness. Now, once we realize this, we can minister and walk from a point of authority. How so? Well, God's power is in his word. He is upholding all things by the word of his power, Hebrews 1:3. You need to learn to minister and walk from a point of authority. In his earthly ministry, Jesus said things like, "Be thou made whole, take up your bed and walk." Then Peter said to the lame man, "In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk," Acts 3:6. So he too ministered and spoke from the point of authority. Now it's time for you as a believer to begin to act that way. You have obtained an inheritance, and in that inheritance you have been given all authority. You have all authority. Listen to me. The God of the universe lives inside of you. He lives and walks in you. Become God inside minded and you will begin to walk in this point of authority. Keep right on building yourself up in your inheritance. You live in a world that's full of evil influences, folks, and Satan would love to get you to forget the reality of being born again and never realize your place of authority in Christ Jesus. Why? Because if you don't forget that power you walk in, if you come into agreement with that power you walk in, get understanding of the power in all of its might, it makes you absolutely and totally dangerous to him. Why? Because Satan has no defense against you when you walk in the power of God's word. When you see in the word that you are constantly when you see in the word that you are in Christ Jesus, okay, and that you are in him, and then when you confess it with all your heart, then you'll be strong, standing at a point of authority and operating in your inheritance in him. As you do this, the power of God will always be available, and Johnny on the spot to work in you on your behalf. Praise God, my friends. Praise God. Glory, hallelujah. Praise God. I hope you got something out of this little reminder. I mean, like I said, this is redundancy, and I know, but it's also, we're calling it immersion because you are totally immersed in the Word of God, and it's over and over and over and over again. So, praise the Lord. Now, I think you need to eat some lunch. It's 12:07. I'm going to give you your time to eat, and then I will pick up from there. Okay? Let me give you some music while you're dining. That'll be soft and beautiful. Sure, soft and beautiful. I guess I could put my glasses on, and that would tell me what it is, whether it's soft and beautiful, huh? All right. Here's an instrumental. Let's do that one. Thank you. power lives in us. Amen? It does. You know, there's a number of keys to seeing the miraculous power of God manifest in our lives on a consistent basis. One of the least understood power, and as a result, we seldom see practiced, is the power of healing, which is under the authority of the believer. We very seldom see it practiced. God has already provided his healing power and placed it on the inside of every born-again believer. It's up to us to release it. Now, understanding and using our authority is the key to seeing all miracles happen. You see, look how Peter and John ministered healing to the lame man in Acts 3, verses 1 through 8. Now, Peter and John went up together into the temple at the hour of prayer, being the ninth hour, and a certain man, lame from his mother's womb, was carried, whom they laid daily at the gate of the temple, which is called Beautiful, to ask for alms of them that entered into the temple, who, seeing Peter and John about to go into the temple, asked an alms. And Peter, fastening his eyes upon him with John, said, "Look on us." And he gave heed unto them, expecting to receive something from them. Then Peter said, "Silver and gold have I none, but such as I have, give I thee. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk." And he took him by the right hand and lifted him up, and immediately his feet and ankle bones received strength. And he, leaping up, stood and walked and entered with them into the temple, walking and leaping and praising God. Okay. Notice that Peter didn't pray for this man. He also didn't ask God to heal him. He said, "Such as I have, give I thee." This didn't mean that Peter was the source of his healing. Notice what Peter said in Acts 3, verse 12. "And when Peter saw it, he answered unto the people, 'You men of Israel, why marvel you at this? Or why look you so earnestly on us, as though by our own power, our holiness, we had made this man walk?'" I want you to understand this. It was God's power that healed this man, but that power was under Peter's authority. Peter went on to say in verse 16 that it was faith in the name of Jesus that had wrought this miracle. But Peter didn't ask God to heal this man. He believed the Lord had already done his part and placed that power within him. Now, it was Peter's responsibility to release that power, and that's just what he did. The Lord never told us to pray for the sick in the sense that we ask him to heal them. What did he tell us? He told us to heal the sick. Now, there's a big difference between the two. It has to do with operating in the authority that he's already given us. Look at these commands the Lord gave his disciples. Then he called his 12 disciples together and gave them power and authority over all devils to cure diseases. And he sent them to preach the kingdom of God and heal the sick. Luke 9, verses 1 and 2. And when he had called unto him his 12 disciples, he gave them power against unclean spirits to cast them out and to heal all manner of sickness and all manner of disease. Matthew 10:1. "And as ye go, preach, saying, 'The kingdom of heaven is at hand,' heal the sick, cleanse the lepers, raise the dead, cast out devils. Freely you have received, freely give." Matthew 10:7-8. Now Jesus told us to heal the sick, not pray for the sick. What a radical statement. This will get you kicked out of most churches today, but these are the exact words of our Lord Jesus. And this is precisely why more people don't see the miraculous results that they're praying for. They aren't taking their authority and commanding God's power. What they are doing is passively asking God to do what he told them to do. Well, that isn't going to work. Now, I know this sits contrary to popular Christian doctrine, and we're constantly told that it's not us, but God who is the healer, right? And I agree with that totally. But I also know that God has placed his healing power under our authority, and it's up to us to release it. So you see, if we don't take our authority and become commanders instead of beggars, God's power will not be released. There needs to be a radical reviewing of our thinking on this issue. A ministry colleague held a meeting in Africa many years ago. It was one of the first times he saw miracles such as the blind and deaf healed, and the people were so excited, they actually were mobbing him as he walked through the streets. They were trying to touch him so they could be healed. Now, his first thought was influenced by this religious thinking that I brought to light just a minute ago. He thought, "They shouldn't be looking to me. I'm not the healer. It's Jesus that's the healer." Well, he was about to stop them when the Lord spoke to him, and the Lord said, "Do you remember when I rode that donkey into Jerusalem, and all the people put their garments and palm branches in the way and cried, 'Hosanna'? What would you have thought if the donkey had spoken up and said, 'It's not me, it's not me'? Wouldn't that only have revealed the donkey's arrogance? I mean, after all, no one was praising the donkey. They were praising the one that was riding the donkey. Now, when he recognized that the people weren't trying to touch him, but the one he was carrying, he let them touch him all they wanted, and the people were healed. This is exactly what happened with the first century disciples. Peter had people lined up in the streets so that if only his shadow would touch them, they would be healed. Acts 5:15. All right, look at this amazing passage of scripture in Isaiah 45:11. Thus saith the Lord, the Holy One of Israel, and his Maker, ask me of things to come concerning my sons, and concerning the work of my hands, command you me. Okay. I mean, hey, what a powerful scripture. What does the Lord mean when he tells us to command him? Command you me. Well, he certainly doesn't mean we're mightier and more powerful than he is. He doesn't mean we can order him around. What he does mean is concerning the things that he's already done. He wants us to take our authority and command his power. It's like electricity, my friends. The power company generates the power and delivers it to your house. It's not your power, but it's under your control. You don't call the power company and ask them to turn the lights on. No, they won't do that. They generate the power, but it's under your command. You simply flip the switch on the wall and command the power to work. Does this mean you are the power source? Certainly not. You can put a light bulb in your mouth and it'll never come on. You aren't the power source, but you are the one in control of what that power does. You can plead with the power company all you want. They are not going to flip that switch for you. I can tell you that right now. You have to assume your authority and acknowledge the power that's under your command. That's what the Lord was speaking of. He has already healed everyone who will ever be healed. And he didn't, you know what he did? He did it in 2,000 years ago when he bore our stripes on his back. Then he deposited his resurrection power inside every believer. Here's your evidence, Ephesians 1:19-20. And what is the exceeding greatness of his power toward us who believe, according to the working of his mighty power, which he worked in Christ when he raised him from the dead and seated him at the right hand in the heavenly places. At his right hand in heavenly places. He has done his part, and now it's up to us to do ours. Now we need to take the authority that he has given us and become commanders instead of beggars. This is a powerful truth that works, and it's the reason why we see so many miraculous healings. I'm going to tell you something. We are acting just like beggars. I hear people's prayers. They come and talk to me, and they'll pray with me, you know, and the first thing that they do is they start to beg. Lord, please help us. Please, please. Oh, please. I just don't, you know, oh, please, Lord. I don't want to be sick. You know, you're the healer. Your word says you are. Please, please, Lord. Please heal me. Please heal me. Please, please. God doesn't like a whiner. You know, he's already said, don't burden him with that. He doesn't want to hear repetitious, vain, utterings. So what must we do? We must teach our people how to pray properly. Always do all things in thanksgiving. Thank him for the answer, because you already have it. It's just not manifested yet. You're pulling it out of the supernatural into the natural. But you have it. If you could see into the supernatural, you'd see it's right there on the brink of coming in. So you just thank him for it. And as you thank him, it keeps moving closer and closer until heaven pushes the natural away and it manifests. Okay? Now, we aren't just praying for the sick. We are healing them in Jesus' name. Now, I know this line of thinking raises as many questions as it does answers, so I produced a teaching on the believer's authority, which I'm sharing with you during this e-crusade so that you will get the foundation built. I've been given by God what might be considered radical teachings. I'm sure that they're considered radical. One example would be, who do you think made Satan? Most people think that God made Satan. But that's not true. God created Lucifer, a wonderful, powerful, godly angel. It was mankind who made Satan. And there's a difference between creating and making. This could revolutionize your whole approach toward the devil. Satan isn't using some superhuman angelic authority against us. He's using the authority and power that was given to man by God. He's using Adam's power, Eve's power. Do you understand? And every time that somebody gives in to the devil and does something, he's taking some power. Satan can't do anything to us without our consent and our cooperation. He can try to deceive us, he can try to distract us, but all he can ever do is offer us the evil that he has thought up for mankind. We have to come into agreement with him and what he says about us in order to receive any sickness or disease at all. Think about this. Hey, my friends, it's the truth of God's word. It's Jesus. If Jesus healed us at the cross 2,000 years ago, why aren't we healed? Why are we subject to sickness and disease? Well, the answer is we're not subject to it. We agree with what the devil says about us, about our condition, about our situation, instead of agreeing with what God's word says about us. It all starts out as a thought, a fiery dart, a thought, and it's sickness and disease that he's going to try to lay on us. He's from the outside working in. He can't get in because you got on the armor of God. So what he's doing is he hates the image and the likeness of God. So what's he doing? He's attacking you. He's attacking that image and likeness. Okay, so you're getting symptoms. You're exhibiting symptoms. And what do? You go to the doctor and you find out what's wrong. Well, I don't know what it is, but tell me what it is. You do it, doctor. You tell me what it is. All right, doctor comes out and gives you an evil report. It says, well, you've got blah, blah, blah. You've got hepatitis C or something. I don't know. And you go, oh, no, I've got hepatitis C. And you go off and you call your friends and you say, oh, the doctor said I have hepatitis C. I have hepatitis C. What are you doing? You're taking it. You're lining your word up with him and you're agreeing with what the devil said about you. Instead, what happens is the doctor gives you an evil report. You have hepatitis C. You say, thank you for giving me a name, because we know that everything that has a name has to bow to the name of Jesus. And you get up and leave. And instead of taking it, you immediately rebuke it. It's not like I rebuke you. You can't do it that way. You have to talk to it. You have to say, you have no place in me, devil. You have no place in me. You have no right to touch me. I'm a child of the living God. And you begin to exhort yourself. Why? Because you need to remind yourself who you are in Christ. By the time you get done reminding yourself of all the things that you are in him, that you know, what's going to happen? That symptom's going to be gone. That's what's going to happen. Now, it may come back. If it comes back, it's because you've allowed it to, so you do it again. Pretty soon, he'll leave you alone. Okay. By his stripes, we were and are healed. You're as healthy as you want to be. I'm telling you the truth. As healthy as you allow the word of God to speak to you. If you're sick, start agreeing with the word of God. Listen, begin speaking life into your body and mind. Start speaking healing scriptures like 1 John 4:17, where it tells us that as Jesus is, so are we in this world. So are we in this world. Then ask yourself, how is Jesus' health? He walks in divine health and wholeness. Well, so do you. And he walks in financial abundance. Hey, so do you. And he's the head and not the tail. Well, so are you. Do you see it? Start coming into agreement with what God says about you. Why? Because that's how God sees you. When you're born again, you are born through Jesus, the Christ. And now the Word of God tells us in Ephesians 5:30, for we are members of his body, flesh of his flesh and bone of his bones. Eve was made from one of Adam's ribs, and Adam said of her, this is now bone of my bone and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman because she was taken out of man. The bridge of the last Adam, the bride of the last Adam, us, taken out of him, is bone of his bone and flesh of his flesh. These two are one. All right? Feet are swollen. I can't get my shoe on. Notice, too, that when the Roman spear was thrust into Jesus' side, water and blood poured out. This is also what happens in childbirth. Lots of water and blood accompany the birth of a child. That day, a bride was born. Just as Eve was taken from the side of Adam, bone of his bone, flesh of his flesh, the bride of Christ was taken from the side of Jesus. And Jesus, the last Adam, says of his bride, you are bone of my bone, flesh of my flesh, and spirit of my spirit. You are not kind of like Jesus. Hello, you are exactly like Jesus. So embrace your inheritance. Begin taking the authority you were given and operating in it. It's a free gift. So open the gift and use it. Since we're talking this year about power and we're delving into our power, we need to talk about the power Jesus delegated to us. The Bible says you shall receive power till Jesus comes. Let's look at that scripture. So when they met together, they asked him, Lord, are you at this time going to restore the kingdom to Israel? He said to them, it is not for you to know the times or dates the Father has set by his own authority. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you. And you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all of Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. I'm sorry, but I have to stand up for a second. I'm uncomfortable. After he said this, he was taken up before their eyes, and and a cloud hid him from their sight. They were looking intently up into the sky as he was going, when suddenly two men dressed in white stood beside them. "Men of Galilee," they said, "why do you stand here looking into the sky? This same Jesus who has been taken from you into heaven will come back in the same way that you have seen him go." Wow. Into heaven. Going to heaven. Then they returned to Jerusalem from the hill called the Mount of Olives, the Sabbath day's walk from the city. When they arrived, they went upstairs to the room where they were staying. Those present were Peter, John, James, and Andrew, James the son of Alphaeus, and Simon the Zealot, and Judas the son of James. They all joined together constantly in prayer, along with the women and Mary, the mother of Jesus, and his brothers. Now, in volume one of Luke's two-volume work, The Gospel According to Luke, he told the story of all that Jesus began to do and to teach. Now, in volume two of the Acts of the Apostles, Luke is going to tell the story of what the risen, living, reigning Jesus Christ continues to do and teach through his Spirit and his witnesses. To prepare the apostles to be his instruments, he does four things. He gives them a spiritual authenticated commandment. He verifies his resurrection from the dead by appearing to them for 40 days. He teaches them about the kingdom of God, and he promises to baptize them with holy water. The Holy Spirit. Testing. Okay. Disciples ask a reasonable question here. When the apostles hear the promise of the baptism with the Holy Spirit, they ask in verse 6, "Lord, will you at this time restore the kingdom to Israel?" And in other words, they knew that the Old Testament promise of the outpouring of God's Spirit was a promise for the last days when God would establish his kingdom on the earth and restore his people. For example, in Ezekiel 39, God says, "I will restore the fortunes of Jacob and have mercy on the whole house of Israel. I will not hide my face anymore from them when I pour out my spirit upon the house of Israel," says the Lord God. Ezekiel 39:25-29. Now, when Jesus says that the long-awaited outpouring of the Spirit and the baptism with the Holy Spirit is just a few days away, well, they would naturally ask for a clarification. Do you mean the end is that close? I mean, is that close to us? The final kingdom is about to be established in just a matter of weeks or months? This wasn't a foolish question, my friends, even though verse 3 says that Jesus had been with them for 40 days talking about the kingdom of God. Because you remember back in Luke 22, verses 29 through 30, at the Last Supper, Jesus had said, "As my Father assigned a kingdom to me, so I assign one to you, that you may eat and drink at my table in my kingdom and sit on thrones judging the 12 tribes of Israel." In other words, Jesus had told them that the kingdom would be restored to Israel. They themselves would sit on thrones as rulers along with the Son of Man over a renewed and believing Israel. They knew from the Old Testament in Ezekiel 39:29, Isaiah 32:15, Isaiah 44:3-5, Joel 2:28, and Zechariah 12:10, that this restoration was going to be the result of a great outpouring of God's Spirit. Now, so it's not foolish to ask a question. I don't think so. I don't think that was a foolish question at all. Do you mean that the restoration is in this time in our lifetime, or even in the next few months? Since it's not a foolish question, Jesus doesn't rebuke them. He doesn't correct their theology of restoration, which we will see more of in Acts 3:21. He corrects their assumption that they can deduce the timing of it. He says in verse 7, "It's not for you to know times or seasons with which the Father has fixed by his own authority." In other words, don't assume that the long-awaited outpouring of the Spirit will immediately bring in the kingdom and restore the fortunes of Israel. God has appointed the times and the seasons for all things, and they are kept in the secret of his own wisdom. Okay, such things are not for us to know, my friends. They would not be good for us to know, any more than knowing the time of our own death would be good for us to know. They wouldn't be. They would be harmful, in fact. But then Jesus goes on to tell them what the baptism with the Spirit will mean for them. It doesn't mean immediate restoration of Israel. It doesn't mean the immediate full establishment of the kingdom, but this is what I want you to know. I want you to notice this strong word at the beginning of verse 8. Here's what it does mean. You shall receive power. All right? In other words, even though I may seem to have popped your balloon in saying that it doesn't mean the end is tomorrow, even though you may think I have taken the wind out of your sails, hear me, though the baptism with the Spirit doesn't mean that yet, but it does mean this. You shall receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be my witnesses in Jerusalem, and in all Judea and in all Samaria and to the ends of the earth. Jesus doesn't want to minimize the wonder of what he's promising them. It's not tomorrow, but it's power to the end of the earth. Now notice four things here. I want you to see them in Luke 24 as well, so that we can sense how utterly crucial they are for Luke as he tells this story. First, there is the goal of beginning at Jerusalem and reaching the end of the earth with the witness of Jesus. Second, there is the witness itself, the testimony to the truth of Christ. Third, there is the Holy Spirit that comes upon the disciples. And fourth, there is the power to be witnesses. Now, turn with me to Luke 24, 47 through 49, and you realize you don't you, that volume, that 1 and 2, volume 2, overlap by 40 days? Mm-hmm. So Luke tells us about the last words and the ascension of Jesus twice at the end of the gospel and at the beginning of Acts. You can see this is now as you compare them, okay? Luke 24, 47 through 49 to Acts 8, 1. Picking up the words of Jesus in verse 47, he is telling the apostles that repentance and forgiveness of sins should be preached in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You're witnesses of these things, and behold, I send the promise of my Father upon you, but stay in the city until you are clothed with power from on high. Now let's point out the four things we saw in Acts 1 and verse 8. First, we see the goal to begin at Jerusalem and reach the end of the earth in verse 47. Forgiveness of sins is to be preached in his name to all the nations, to the end of the earth, beginning from Jerusalem. Second, the apostles are called witnesses in verse 48. You are the witnesses of these things. Third, the Holy Spirit is promised in the words, the promise of my Father in verse 49. These are the words in Acts 1 through 4 that refer to the coming baptism with the Holy Spirit. Finally, there is explicit reference in verse 49, and this is item 4, to the power needed for this mission to stay in the city until you're clothed in power from on high. Then in both Luke 24 and Acts 1, the very next thing that happened was the ascension of Jesus. He was taken up from them, and a cloud received him out of their sight. Acts tells us that two men in white robes, in other words, two angels in the form of men, said in verse 11, "Men of Galilee, why do you stand looking into the heaven? This Jesus who was taken up from you into heaven will come in and the same way that you saw him go to heaven." Luke 21, 27. So the last words that Jesus said in Luke 24 and in Acts 1 are clearly meant to be words to guide his disciples in the time between his ascension and his return. Amen? So let's get back now and ponder these things again. And in conclusion, we'll look ahead to verse 14 to see how the disciples prepared to receive the power of God. Well, let me ask you, is the power of God promised when, then, and available now?
Okay.
Excuse me. One crucial question that we need to ask is whether the power promised in Acts 1 and 8 and Luke 24 and 49 were for only the first generation of Christians, or whether it's something we should seek from Jesus today. Okay. So, I'm sorry. I'm just miserable. I'm so hot I can't get comfortable, and I'm not on my chair comfortably, so forgive me, please, as I try to scoot around here and get some air. I'm just a wiggle worm. All right, so the question is again, the question was whether the power promised in Acts 1, verse 8, and Luke 24, verse 9, verse 49, was only for the first generation of Christians, or whether it's something we should seek from Jesus today. Now, before I answer that, let me emphasize that this power, this experience of the coming upon, or being clothed by the Holy Spirit, was something beyond ordinary, happy Christian living. In the Old Testament, being clothed with the Spirit referred to extraordinary times of empowerment and prophecy in the lives of Gideon and Amasai, and Zechariah. Judges 6:34, 1 Chronicles 12:18, and 2 Chronicles 24:20. But it's most obvious from what happened on the day of Pentecost, wind and sound and tongues of fire and miraculous languages and prophecy and exuberant praise and 3,000 conversions. Well, let me use an illustration from Martin Lloyd-Jones in his book Joy Unspeakable to describe the difference between common Christian living and what happens when the Holy Spirit clothes a person with power or comes upon a person with this unusual power. He says it's like this. This is what it says. He says it like a child. It's like a child walking along holding his father's hand. All is well. The child is happy. He feels secure. His father loves him, and he believes that his father loves him, but there's no unusual urge to talk about this or sing about it. It's true and it's pleasant. Then suddenly the father startles the child by reaching down and sweeping him up into his arms and hugging him tightly and kissing him on his face, just all over and over again on his neck and whispering, I love you so much. And then holding back the stunned child back away from him so he can look into his face and saying with all of his heart, I'm so glad you're mine. Then hugging him once more and with unspeakable warmth and affection. Then he puts the child down, and this is what happens. When a person is baptized with the Holy Spirit, this is exactly what happens. A pleasant and happy walk with God is swept up into an unspeakable new level of joy and love and assurance. And in reality is that it leaves the Christian so utterly certain of the immediate reality of Jesus that he's overflowing in praise and more free and bold in witness than he ever could have imagined he could be. Now the child is simply stunned. He doesn't know whether to cry or shout or fall down or run. He's happy, so the fuses of the love are so overloaded that they almost blow out. Okay, the subconscious doubts that he wasn't thinking about that at the time, but that pop up every now and then, comes from there, and then they're gone, you know. And in their place is utter and an indestructible assurance, so that you know that you know that you know that God is real and that Jesus lives and that you are loved. And that to be saved is the greatest thing in the world. So as you walk down the street, you can scarcely contain yourself, and you want to cry out, my father loves me, my father loves me. Oh, what a great father I have. What a father, what a father. This, or something very nearly like it, is basically what happened at Pentecost and has happened again and again and again in the life of the church. They were so filled with the fullness of God that they were overwhelmed with the length and breadth and height and depth of the love of Christ, that they began, as Acts 2:11 says, to speak the greatness of God, and their mind was full of a fresh, new, breathtaking vision of God, and their mouth overflowed with prophetic praise. Sons and daughters, old and young, slave and free, this kind of experience is just what Jesus meant by the witnessing in Acts 1:8, that we are in Acts 1:8, that will enable us to extend the gospel to the end of the earth. You will receive this power and you will be my witnesses. You will no longer be merely advocates who can prove like a good lawyer that Jesus is dead, rose from the dead. All right? But under the influence of this power, this experience of the Spirit of the risen Christ, you will speak with an unwavering you'll speak with the unwavering assurance of one who has tasted and knows the reality, so to speak, that's all gone. Okay, you move from being an advocate of Christianity to being a witness of the living Christ. You move from simply deducing Christian truths from valid premises to proclaiming them boldly as experienced realities. This is the power and the witness that will take Christ to the end of the earth. So, I ask in closing, is it for us, just for the first generation that Jesus was talking to? And my answer is that it is for us. And the one argument I will give is simply this. The promise of this extraordinary power, this extraordinary experience of the fullness of God is given. Jesus says to enable his witnesses to take the gospel to the end of the earth, Acts 1:8, or as Luke 24:47 says, to all the nations. But we have not completed that assignment yet. Therefore, he has withdrawn the promise either yet. But if the promise was given to empower the church to complete the Great Commission, then the promise is valid till the Great Commission is complete, and the witness to Christ has been planted among all the unreached people, in groups or otherwise, of the world. Therefore, I conclude that the power promised here, the extraordinary promise of God, of his being clothed with power, is for us. And if we love the Lord your God, our God, and if we long for his kingdom to advance, and if we have compassion on the lost and hurting people of the world, we will increasingly get more power, you know, and that's it. It's more power. We'll increasingly want this power, and we will seek this power, which means very simply that we will cry out for it, like the woman at the parable who wanted the judge to vindicate her cause in Luke 18:1-8. Now this is what Acts 1:14 says that the disciples did until Pentecost came. They devoted themselves to prayer. So should we? Well, that leaves one last question. Are you leading a valid, worthwhile Christian life and ministry if you haven't had this experience, but are seeking to honor the Lord daily in your life? The answer is yes. Yes, let's call that solid person and see what's going on, why she called. Christianity is faithful, honest, obedient, loving, persevering service to Christ and His kingdom. And consequently, remember the child walking with his father, who I don't want to, you want us to minimize the blessings, but God brought us to this example in our present state. Christian life altogether, they have been built many and wonderful, but I ask you, they've built everything. They've built churches everywhere, cathedrals everywhere, holy water by the gallon, you name it, they've got it. But this is what I want to ask you. Can you imagine what it might be like if our Father swept up into His arms when we got there, that He just picked us up into His arms? It's both of us, it's both and. In the history of the church and state, the steady state of the obedient, faithful, persevering years of life have preserved and nurtured, and the fruit of the times of extraordinary power, and to put it another way, the times of steady state, faithful, obedient life have prepared the soil and extraordinary outpourings of God's Spirit have taken place. They've taken the work of the kingdom forward in a quantum leap, accomplishing overnight, as it were, the people that have been laboring for years to see. It's not either or, my friends. It's both and. Pray that the Lord will give us a double portion for His double grace, the grace to walk joyfully and obediently in the wonderful mercy of the steady state, Christianity holding our Father's hand, but also the grace to learn, yearn, and pray more and more, that we might be clothed with power from on high and swept up into our Father's arms, that all the world might know that God is real. We are not to underestimate the power of God that has been poured into us in the U.S. It is, after all, the very same power that raised Jesus from the dead. As Christian walks with God can become increasingly aware, even in the midst of his troubles, that he is receiving foretastes of God's ultimate promise to the eternal life, and God's Spirit is not inactive. He demonstrated that in raising Jesus from the dead of life, that Jesus Christ, was raised from death to life, that, my friends, is resurrection power. And we have that same power living inside of us. Surely, we should expect some clear demonstration of the reality of his work in us. How could that same power that raised Jesus from the dead not make a massive tangible difference if living inside of us? You have the power. Now, are you ready to learn how to use it? I hope you got something out of this today. It's been my pleasure to deliver that. I think what we're going to do here is I'll look at my time and see what time it is. It's 12:52. It's almost 1 o'clock. And I have... I don't have anybody scheduled till 1:30, and I don't have a half an hour message. So I'm going to give you some downtime, okay? I need a break. Separated.
Creation.
Father, we come into your presence in the name of Jesus the Christ. We have a full heart overflowing from our lips. We dwell in the secret place of the Most High. We love you and magnify you. We praise your precious holy name. We thank you that you have already heard our prayers, and we praise you that your word tells us that all of your answers for the believer's prayers are yes and amen. Father, we glorify you. We are just living, breathing attributes of you, and we thank you that your word tells us that all the believers' prayers are yes, answers are yes and amen, because you sent your son to save us and take all sickness, disease from our midst. You know what, Father, we know we're healed. We were healed at the cross. You made us whole and completely restored, and we give you all the honor, glory, and praise for that in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, I hope that you all came expecting to receive. All right, because if you didn't come to receive, you're not going to get anything. But if you came to receive, open your minds and your hearts, you know, and be ready to receive from us. Because even if you don't agree with us, nobody says you have to agree with us, but open your mind and receive the worth and the wealth of the word. And you know what will happen? The Holy Spirit will resonate. It'll resonate with your spirit, and it'll tell you that this is the truth. But instead of just say, okay, I'm taking that pastor's word for it, don't do that. Take those scriptures, take that message that you've taken notes on, and go to the Bible and research it yourself. You first get it in your ears and in your ear gates, hearing by faith comes by hearing and hearing and hearing, right? And then you go and you get it in your eye gates to verify it, all right? Now, I'm going to talk to you today for just a brief moment before our next speaker comes in. Because I want you to know that you're bone of Jesus' bone and flesh of his flesh. Now, in order for you to grasp a hold of who you are in Christ so that you can operate in the power that you have, you need to understand this. You know, this is from the Word of God, and the Lord shared with me, and it's life-changing, my friends. You need to get a hold of it. So let's talk about our being bone of his bone and flesh of his flesh. Our text for this message is Ephesians chapter 5, verse 30, and it tells us, "For we are members of his body, of his flesh, and of his bones." Now look at Luke 24, verse 39. "Behold my hands and my feet, that it is I myself. Handle me and see, for a spirit hath not flesh and bones, as you see me have." Okay, this is where I'm going with this. Through the Apostle Paul, in Ephesians chapter 5, verse 30, the Holy Spirit is referring to Genesis chapter 2, verse 23. There, it tells us that Why not give me fits? There it tells us this. And Adam said, "This is now bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman because she was taken out of man." I want to say it again. I want you to listen to it. Adam said, "This is now bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh." Give it some thought. "She shall be called woman because she was taken out of man." Now this is what we see here. God literally took one of Adam's bones and made the body of his wife. And now we can probably understand some of that because of what we know about DNA today. Her body was, let me get rid of some stuff here. I'm sorry, it's making me crazy. Oh dear, did I lose my thing? All right, just a minute. I erased my outline, my little outline of my, there we go. Please forgive me. I'll try to, okay, open up. All right, let me do that. Okay, we know something about DNA today, and we have a better understanding of it, right? So we can probably figure out that because of what we know about DNA and how they are reproducing animals and stuff, that this is possible. That God made her body exactly like Adam's, except the gender. And Ephesians 5:30 is referring to this because as Adam's wife came out of him, ready? Adam's wife came out of him. When we are born again, we come out of Jesus. What's our evidence? Let's take a look. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 10. We are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus. Here's this twinkling of an eye experience. Like the caterpillar who goes into a chrysalis and stays that way for however long and then emerges as a butterfly. He's no longer a caterpillar, he's a butterfly. He'll never be a caterpillar again. He can't go backwards. Neither can you, all right? All right, we go into, we're not like a caterpillar, but I'm using that as an example. We go not into a chrysalis, we go into Christ. We accept him as Lord and Savior, and we immediately, in the twinkling of an eye, move into Christ. It's a great exchange that happens. We move into Christ. And here's the deal. We don't come out. We stay there. We are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus. We are spiritually born again, and we come through Christ, but we stay in him. Look at 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17. "Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new." Now, I want you to take special notice once again at the word creature or creation. You see, this is not a remodeling job. This is a new species of being, born of a different source or seed. That's right. So, 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 23 explains this really clearly. I'm going to read it to you. "Being born again, not of corruptible seed, but of incorruptible, by the word of God, which liveth and abideth forever." So, you're not a little bit like Jesus. I just told you this last time when we were talking. You're not a little bit like Jesus. You are exactly like Jesus. You are bone of his bone and flesh of his flesh. We have the exact same spiritual DNA because we, Jesus, you and me, we were all born of the word. But now, what's so exciting about Ephesians 5:30 is that we are not only one with the Spirit of the Lord, we are flesh of his flesh and bone of his bone. Do you see this? He has given us his bones. He's given us his flesh. He's given us his organs. I want you to get a hold of this. His bones are not diseased. His flesh has no sickness in it. Are you getting excited yet? You know, one of my colleagues had a meeting in Washington, D.C., and he said that the Lord came to him saying this, "In my sacrifice, I gave you my flesh and my bones. In Romans 12:1, you gave me your flesh and your bones. I took yours, and now you take mine." Listen, get your Bible out. I want to look this up. Romans 12:1. Okay, let's go there. We know the other. I quoted it to you. "You're born of my bone, flesh of my flesh." Now we're going to go to Romans chapter 12, verse 1, Romans, because I want you to see it. You need to look at it with your own little eyes. Romans chapter 12, verse 1. Here we go. This is what he said, that what Jesus said. "I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that ye present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. All right. You gave him your flesh and bones there. He took yours and you took his. All right? Now listen to this, my friends. Hallelujah. I gave him mine and he gave me his. I took his flesh for my flesh. I took his bones for my bones. I took his organs for my organs. I took it all. I walk in his divine health and have for years. I walk in health, divine health, wholeness, and complete restoration. Look, his flesh has no cancer, no tumors, no fever, no infection. It has no part of the curse. His brain is part of his flesh. And it has no memory loss, no Alzheimer's, no mental illness, no dementia. I take his brain. I have the mind of Christ, and now I have his brain in which that mind of Christ in me can work. Think about this. We are one spirit with the Lord. We have his flesh, we have his bones, and through Holy Communion, we have his blood. Now, you know, I was taught years ago that there are six I's of faith, not E-Y-E, but I, the letter I. And that I was taught this years ago, and it goes this way. I believe, I will, I take it, I have it, I thank you, I forgive. So let's do it now. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, I believe I will. I take your flesh. I take your bones. I am one spirit with you. I have your blood. You gave it to me. I have your flesh. I have your bones. I have your organs. I am so grateful to you. Thank you. And now I forgive if I have aught against any. Mark 11:25, and that brings us to Romans 12:1. I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. Take note, this is mercy speaking, my friends. Mercy is calling your body holy, H-O-L-Y, holy, and he's calling it acceptable. He's calling for it just like it is, not after you've tried to clean it up. He has given you his body, and it's already clean. Give him your body. Give it up to him. Stop calling it my body. From this day forward, call it my sacrifice. That will start in motion Romans chapter 12, verse 2, the renewing of your mind. This living sacrifice, you, belongs to Jesus. His living sacrifice, his body, belongs to me, belongs to you. Now, here we are, right here at 1 John chapter 4, verse 17. I always end up here. Herein is our love made perfect, that we may have boldness in the day of judgment, because as he is, so are we in this world. Now that he, that they're referring to, is Jesus. Listen, I want to go back here. Let's go back to this sermon again, or this scripture. Earlier, Dr. Sherry told you in one of her sermons that the word perfect in scripture means mature. All right? Herein is our love made mature, that we may have boldness in the day of judgment, because as he is, so are we in this world. How is he? Tell me, how is he? Look at that. Right this minute, right today. As he is, so are we right now in this world. Where, in heaven? No, in this world. Because it's not referring to heaven later or whatever. Shout it, it says in this world. How is he? He's strong, so are we. He's in abundance. Hey, walks in abundance. So do we. We are in him, he in Christ, and he is in us. He has victory over sickness and disease. So do we. He has victory over death. So do we. How? He gave us victory over death. Did you get this today? It's a brief, brief message, but it's so important. It is so big. It's huge. You know, I can't impress upon you enough what it really is, because it's got to be. Oh, no, I don't want to do that. Get the wrong thing. It has to be huge, because who you are in Christ is huge. It's absolutely, positively huge. So, I need to open this and get ready to move somebody in here. It's not... Oh, here it comes. It wasn't going to let me. It didn't let me. It's something else. I'm going to do this. I want to do that. I don't know why I have to What happened? Oh, okay, there it is. That was scary. My whole screen went blankety blank. I want you to stop that. Hear that? Something is not right in Denmark. Quit it. Well, I don't know. Let's get out of that altogether. And, because it's not letting me do anything. It's just twanging like an old rubber band. Okay. It's vitally important. This is huge. The reason is because it's part and parcel of your power. When you're in Christ, you have His power. Not just your own, you have His power. So think about it. You have got to come to grips with it. You don't just have the authority, you have His power, because you're bone of His bone and flesh of His flesh. You are the only Christ that anybody's going to see down here. And some other born-again believer is the only Christ anybody's going to see down here. You know what I mean? We are Jesus Christ in the doing and of the scriptures, of what we're supposed to be doing. I know that that sounds kind of hokey, and I know that you don't believe me, but you know what? Believe it. It's true. It's true. Begin taking responsibility is the word I'm looking for. Begin taking responsibility for yourself. Begin taking responsibility for it's not going to let me do that, and I don't know why. Well, that's terrible, y'all. I guess I can't get my people online. Anyway, begin taking responsibility for yourself. Begin taking responsibility for who you truly are in Christ. Don't be afraid of the power. Step into it. You're never going to know what it is until you try it, right? And you know you're not wielding the power out of trying to be big in your own eyes. You're not fully yourself. You're trying to do it so that you can test the water, so you know that you what power you have, so you can wield it for God. And He'll be there with you. He's right there with you every step of the way. I want to know what this is. I'm sorry, folks. I've got to see. You hear that little boing boing and everything? I'm trying to get my Skype thing to do something, and it isn't helping me. I'm gonna quit it altogether. And I'm gonna quit it again and get rid of it. No. I need to. It won't let me get into my peeps. It freezing me. Freezing. Well, I just don't know what to tell you. Great. That's what I need, isn't it? Well, all right. Nothing like having a few, glitches. I don't know. This is great. Well, it won't even let me do that. I won't be able. I don't have access to my speakers today. It's gone. Oh no. Maybe it'll give it to me for a minute. That's terrible. Well, I'll tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to close this entire program, and then I'll start it again, and that includes all of us. So go have some lunch, all right? And I'll be coming back online in about 10 minutes. God bless you, and I'll see you later.